that talked about the measures of central attendance. We looked at the mean, median, mode, and we went for us to look at range. And we saw so many examples on mean, median, mode, and range. But today we're looking at data presentation. We have some methods of presenting data on the board. We have a use of pie chart, we have bar chart, we have bar line, we have frequency distribution table, and we have pictographs. We have frequency distribution table, bar charts, bar line, pictograph, and pie chart. We're going to be working on them separately, one at a time. The first, we have frequency distribution table, so that data can be presented in the form of tables and charts for better understanding. Now, before data is being presented in this form, we call it raw data. It is where it is being presented in this form, we say it's called a processed data. When data is first collected without being processed, we call it raw data. As we have on the board, these are examples of raw data. But when we now present it in forms of tables and charts, like in our frequency distribution table, we now call them processed data. Now we have an example. The following are scores of students in a mathematics test. These are the scores of students in a mathematics test. We refer to this as raw data. We are now to present it in a frequency distribution table. We are to present in a frequency distribution table. So, please. Present it in, will I call it a frequency table or a frequency distribution table? So for us to present this in a frequency or distribution table, we have a table of scores, tally, and frequency. We have a table of scores, tally, and frequency. Now, tally refers to mark or stroke. We call it mark or stroke used to represent data values. While frequency refers to the number of times a particular data value occurs. Tally refers to mark or stroke used to represent data values and always in groups of 5. While frequency refers to the number of times a particular data value occurs. Now, from this, our raw data, we are to present it in a frequency distribution table. The scores of students in mathematics tests ranging from 1 to 9. The scores of the students range from 1 to 9. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. Now we fill in the tally table. We count the number of students that have 1 in the test. We have 1. We have 2 students. So we present our tally 1, 2. The number of students that have 2, we have 1, we have 2, we have 3, we have 4, we have 5. Let's begin 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So in our tally, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. For frequency of the first one is 2. Now we use the fifth stroke to underline the first 4 to have our 5. So our frequency, we have 5. For number of students that have 3, we have 1. We have 2. 1. And we have 2. So our stroke, we have 1, 2. And frequency of 2. Number of students that have 4, we have 1. We have 2. Let's check again. We have 1. And we have 2. So for our tally table, we have 1, 2, and a frequency of 2. For 5, we check. For 5, we have just 1. Let's confirm. For the number of students that have 5 in the test, we have just 1. So for our tally is 1, and our frequency is 1. For number of students that have 6, we have 6. There is no 6. So there's no 6, our frequency is 0. 7. So 7, we have 1, we have 2, we have 3, 4, 5. 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So our tally, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. For eight, we have one, we have two. One, two, and the frequency we have two. For nine, we have one, just one, we have one and one. That's our frequency distribution term. Let's compare that. So we have a group of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, about 20 students. So the sum of our frequency should give us 20. We have 7, 9, 11, 12, 17, 19, and 20. 2 plus 5 is 7, plus 3 is 9, 11, 12, 17, 19, and 20. So our sum of frequency is 20, so we are in order. Now, we're trying to let's do a brief recap. We are explaining frequency distribution term as a method of data presentation. And we see that the data can be presented in form of tables and charts. And we see that before this data is being presented in form of tables and charts, we call them raw data here because they are not yet processed. These are raw data because they are not yet processed. It is when we now present it in this form that we call them processed data. And we say for our frequency distribution table, we have our score, our tally, and our frequency. We say the tally is a mark or strobe to represent our data values, while our frequency is the number of times our data value occurs. So we have counted the number of students that had one ranging from 1 to 9, because the least score is 1 and the highest is 9. So having done that, we have gotten the frequency. We say frequency is the number of times a particular data value occurs. The number of students that had 1 is 2, 2 is 5, 3 is 2, 4 is 2, 5 is 1, 6 is 0, 7 is 5, 8 is 2, 9 is 1. So the number of students that had, see the scores of the students and their frequency, their corresponding frequency on the other side. So this is how to represent data values using a frequency distribution term to represent data. Next, we'll be looking at is a bar chart as a method of data presentation. Bar chart, as we can, you can see on the board, you see it's a rectangular bar of equal width drawn in a length proportional to the magnitude of the numbers being represented. Now we have an example on the board. We'll use this information we have to draw a bar chart so that we can see all the features we have here. So we have here this table showing the average temperature in Lagos from the month of April to December 2009. You can see the average temperature in degrees Celsius. We are going to use this to plot a bar chart. So we have our bar. You see, on our vertical lines, we have our temperature in degrees Celsius. And here we have our months. So our month ranges from, we have January, we have February, and another. Let's start. From our month, we have ranging from, the highest figure we have here is 34. And the least we have is 24. Let's see how we plot the graph. Our temperature, these are axes for temperature, and on the horizontal, we have our month. From April to December. So we have here April. And for April, we have 25 degrees Celsius. 25 degrees Celsius. So we draw a line to this point. 25 falls in between 20 and 30. So at the midpoint between 20 and 30, we have here. This. April. For May, we have 33. We have 33, that should be between 30 and 35. We have 35, so it should be between 30 and 35. So we have our main. Then June is 24. Now we, for our June, should be between 20 and 25, somewhere close to 25. So we have it down here. Then for July, we have 34. July is 34, between 30 and 35, very close to 35. So we have it using a graph group or ruler to measure, so it might not be very accurate. The 34 should be coming. So this should come up. Okay, now for this is June, this is July. Then we have August 32. August is 32. September is 30. We have our 30. Oh, very close to 32. Then October. October is 24. October is 24. That's close to 25. We have it coming here. November should be 34. November should be 34, just like July. So November should fall in here. Then December 25. December should be 25. Here we have our December falling at this point. This is December. Here is our month. Now these are bar charts. It's just that mine is a freehand drawing. When drawing this bar chart, ensure to use pencil and ruler to make sure that the lines are straight. So this one is a freehand drawing, so it's not that accurate. You see that a bar chart is a rectangular bar of equal width. If you check all these bars, they are rectangular in shape. And their width are equal, meaning that all this is the width. From this point is the width, it should be equal in all the bars. Mine was not measured, but you use your pencil and ruler to measure and ensure that their rectangular width, are equal. If I need 3 cm for this, it should go across. From this point to this point is the width up to the end should be equal. And we also say that they are drawn in lengths that are proportional to the magnitude of the numbers. Just like we have our numbers here. The length should be proportional to the numbers. Just like we have here, the length of 25 degrees Celsius should be proportional. That's the number that should be proportional to our bar. The length of this bar should be proportional to the number. Just like we have here, 25, it should be proportional to this. This 33 should be proportional to this. And so for that, ensure that you measure. It's also advisable to use the graph for proper measurement. Ensure that you measure out. The distance from here to here should be the same with this, 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 and so on and so forth. The distances, the spaces from here to here, this is the origin. If you are using 1 cm, you should go across all through. Not here having a different distance or space from this. No. You ensure that the spaces should be the same. So you can use your meter rule to measure, let's say 1 cm for 5 units or 1 cm for 1 unit, as the case may be, depending on your table. But just make sure that the spaces here should be the same. Spaces here should be the same. Also, the spaces apart, you can see mine is. I was trying to minimize space, but the spaces apart should be the same too. The space here should be the same with this, should be the same with this, and all three. Their spaces apart should be the same. Their width should also be the same. Ensure you use your pencil and ruler to make sure that your lines are straight. Now that's how to represent data values in a bar chart. I also say that we have two types of bar chart, the single bar chart and the compound or the component bar chart. What we have presented on the board is an example of the single bar chart. Perhaps, if there is no time in next class, we'll look at the component or compound bar chart. Okay, let's look at an example on the board. The bar chart below shows the scores of students in a test. We have the bar chart on the board. We have 4 students, Adu, Odo, Etim, and Dukun. They wrote a test, and this chart indicates their scores. Now from this chart, you have to answer the questions that follows. Who scored the highest mark? Now how do we know who scored the highest mark? We look at our bar chart. The longest bar tells us who scores the highest mark. So looking at this, we see that the longest bar falls under Adu. So we say Adu, who scored the highest mark? We say Adu scored the highest mark. And he had 40 mark, and that was the highest score. Judging from our bar chart, he has the longest bar of 40, so that was the highest score. Who scored the lowest mark? Look at the lowest bar. We have the lowest bar here falling under it, Ethan. So Ethan scored the lowest mark. We have Ethan scored the lowest mark. And Ethan's score is 25, because it falls under 25. The midpoint between 20 and 30. So we say 25 marks. The next, which two students scored the same marks? Which two students scored the same marks? You can see that Odor and Okun scored the same marks. That's 30 marks. Odor and Okun. You can see that their two bars are the same. So we say Odor and Okun scored the same marks. They would score 30 marks. And the last we have, find the average mark of the students. Find the average mark of the students. We did this last week. For us to find the average marks, we find their separate marks first. For how do we have 40 marks? So we get 40. For Odor, we have 30. So you see, Odor is 30. For Ethan, we have 25. Ethan, we have 25. And for Okun, we have 30. And we have 30 marks. For us to find the average, we add their marks. 40 plus 30 will give us 70. It's 70. Plus 25 will give us 95. Plus 30, we have 125 marks. This is our total. Let's add again. 40 plus 30 is 70. Plus 25, we have 95. Plus 30, we have 125. We now say average. Give us 125 over 4. 125 over 4. We divide through 4 into itself is 1 into 12, we have 3. There's no remainder. Into 5, we have 1. 1 over 4. This is our average. We can also write it in decimal as 31.25 as our average. Average is now 31.25. That's your either grade 4 or grade 5 work. Conversion from fraction to decimal will give you 1 over 4 will give you 0.25. So we have 31.25 marks as our average. Okay, let us do a brief summary. We are given this question showing the bar chart, and we are to use to answer the questions that follow. So the first question, who scored the highest mark? And we look at our bar chart, the one with the longest bar, the name that represents the longest bar scored the highest. And from that we have that Alvin had as the longest bar, so he had scored the highest mark of 40. Who scored the lowest? We check the bar that is the shortest of all, or the smallest of all, and it falls under Ethan. So with that, Ethan scored the lowest mark of 25. Then, which two students scored the same? We check the two bars that are the same. That's Odor and Okun are the same, so they scored the same marks of 30. Then we have to find the average mark. We sum all the total. Remember what we did last week and 2 weeks before now, how to find the mean. So we sum all the scores and divide by the number of scores we have. We have about 4 students and 4 scores. So we sum the 4 scores and divide by 4. That we did to get 125 as the total scores of the students and divide by 4. But we have 1, 2, 3, 4. So we divide 2 by 4. 4 into 12, you have 3. No remainder. 4 into 5 is 1 remainder 1, then all over 4. So you have 31 over 1 over 4, which we express as decimals, you get 31.25. So that is our average. That is the average of the 4 students. We remember our bar chart, what we said about the bar chart, that the spaces in between should be the same as from here. This space should be the same with this, this, and this. And their width should also be the same. Or should also be the same. Also here, the spaces should be the same. Before we number, the space here should be the same with this, and so on, and so forth. With that, we have come to the end of the class today. We talked about frequency distribution, and we have looked at two methods today. The frequency distribution table and bar chart as two methods of data presentation. There are so many others, but for today we'll stop here. I won't give you any assignment today because I've given you so many assignments and yet to get it from you. So I'll leave you to do your assignment and submit as soon as you can. Keep on being good students, stay safe, and solve many questions as many as possible. You have your past questions with you. Remember, you are in an exam class. Keep on solving problems, solving mathematics problems, as many as you can. Be good students to your parents. Stay safe and see you next week.